So the two oxygen sensors that are out on my car, the one bottom one, which is the bank one sensor two, then the one right here, this is the hardest one to read, bank two sensor one, which is the top sensor right against the firewall. Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. So if you recall from some of my early videos when I first got this Sport Cross project, I had a couple of check engine lights for the heating circuit on the O2 sensor. So I bought new O2 sensors to install. So today I'm gonna show you how to remove the two O2 sensors I've got to do on here. It's the two of the harder O2 sensors too to reach. Since I have my car taken apart already from doing my timing belt service, we'll show you the details on how to get that O2 sensor out and put in the new one. So the two oxygen sensors that are out on my car, the one bottom one, which is the bank one sensor two, then the one right here, this is the hardest one to reach, bank two sensor one, which is the top sensor right against the firewall. So both of these sensors are difficult as hell to get to. I picked up this Amazon oxygen sensor kit, and hopefully it has enough bits in it. Let me reach it. Back there, there's like a crowfoot one and then a couple of other ones. So I picked up this O2 removal kit from Amazon. It was like 20 bucks. They have them all over Amazon. It was actually a red box and they sent me a blue box, but it didn't really matter. It's really what's inside. So this is your regular deep socket that most of the time you would use if you have straight access. So that one, I'll try that first to see if I get to that one that's more accessible. I think that one, the one that's easy to get to, I could use that. That one that's against the firewall, I'm gonna have to use this guy right here. So this is a little crowfoot, that's what they call it. I was looking at it, I might have to put it in like backwards, but actually no, I have to put it in this way because that's where the heck. So I gotta put it in there and then somehow get a deep enough extension and a breaker bar to reach into there and break that thing loose from the header. It comes with this deeper one too, and this one uses a star bit, which I don't have a star bit. Not gonna be useful to me. I'd have to pick up one of the star bits to be able to use that one. But also that one's, I think it's too long to fit against the firewall anyway, so we'll go ahead and give this a shot now. So one of the first things you gotta do before you start taking it apart is unplug the O2s from the harness. Both the ones for the bank one are up here. The plugs, there's one up here and there's one down here. They're two different type plugs, so you can't really confuse them. If you look at this one, it's that style right there. And then this side's got a different style where the plugs and everything are a little different. And I noticed that the top one here looks like it's been replaced at some point because the coloration of the plug is a little different. And the inside is a little bit different, unless it's just the way that it is for the being a different plug. And then it's still got all the OEM Loom in it. So that suggests that this is either the original factory ones from the 18 years ago, or someone replaced it with an original Toyota one that came with that Loom. And that bottom one that's right there, that on the bank one, I think it's easier to get underneath the car to take out. So I'm gonna go get tools and then get underneath the car and access that stuff. The hardest one would be the one on the firewall, like I told you guys earlier. Right there, and then the plug is up here to the valve cover. The fourth one is under the car, and you actually gotta go into the floor to get that one. So after getting that first one off with ease because of the access, the second one has been a pain. I tried the crowfoot, couldn't get it. Now I tried the regular socket, can't get it. Well, I got it in there, but then the ratchet doesn't have any swing. I might have to unbolt the 8 volts right here for the header and take the exhaust manifold off or pop it off the engine so I could get a little bit more room and leverage to actually turn that wrench back there. So I finally got it lined up. I had to pop this thing off, get it perfect, and get that wrench straight so I get some leverage. So now I've got a little bit of swing. So see if it pops. Make sure it's tight. It's got a good spot. Oh yeah, there it goes.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, baby.
Okay. Woo! Oh man, that was a freaking pain. I've been messing around with this for like an hour just trying to get the crow foot at the right angle. It's kind of tight back there, so I can't get through it. I had to pull this thing out, in, out, so I had to pop it back in a little bit. Whoever, the engineer that designed this needs to be shot. Should have freaking put it on this side, which I don't understand why he didn't just put the O2 on this side. It was accessible. Yeah, the crow foot kind of slipped inside there too, where just because it has that gap right here. But anyways, oh man, I'm never gonna mess with this again. So I got all these out and comparing them side by side. So if you remember, that longer one was like $64, $65 one, and that shorter one was only like $42, $43. So there's still the same sensor, but I think that one is more readily available, the shorter one, because it's used in like Camrys and other four cylinders and a lot more common cars, so they sell a lot more of those, so they can afford to sell those cheaper. This one's not as common, so that's probably why it's more expensive. If you look at here, these two were the original OEM sensors I just took out. They still say Toyota on them. The new ones just say Denso. The old ones say Toyota, the part number, and then they've actually got Denso on them also. But overall, pretty much a plug and play ordeal with these. I am a little bit OCD about stuff, so I wanna go ahead and take off this Loom right here and put it over to the new one just to have it the same, because those are around the areas where I think it's high heat, so they put extra Loom there. I'm gonna move like these wire management things over also onto the new one. Thinking about transferring the old stuff over, but then I said screw it, was too much work, so I just ended up just grabbing some wire Loom I have and some 3M electrical tape. I make sure I always use 3M electrical tape on my cars, because over all the years of experience, every other cheap electrical tape is gonna end up rotting on you and just peeling. This is a 3M 33 Plus. They make a couple different grades. I usually use the Super 33 Plus, it's pretty good. I know they make a higher grade, like a Super 88. That I haven't tried yet. It's a little bit more expensive. This one's only like $2 or something for like a 25 foot roll at Home Depot. I think on Amazon you get like a 66 foot roll for like $7 or $8 too. So that's what I always use on my car projects now, just to make sure that it holds up and it doesn't peel on me and get brittle and all that. It's pretty soft. It's a high temperature and a low temperature. I was able to make all that. I had a whole bag of those clips right here, exact same OEM clip right here, so I was able to use that one. So and I reused that one because I didn't break it. That's the one near the valve cover. I'm gonna go ahead and put all this back together now. So I got both of these babies ready to go back in. So these things come with this anti-seize, this copper anti-seize, so you want to put that onto the threads all around it liberally before you start putting it in there. And then with it like this, I kind of put my headers back in. Now I have better access now. I could reach in there, just kind of hand screw these in. And then once I hand screw them in, I can just tighten them with that crow foot. I'm not gonna over tighten them, because in the future I wanna be able to take them off again and I don't want them to seize. That's why we wanna use this anti-seize compound. So I was able to get everything back together, got those O2 sensors tightened down, got all the wire management done like it was OEM and stock. I got those factory zip ties in there on the wall and plugged it all up and cleaned it up. Overall, it was a pretty difficult, that lower one is really easy to get to underneath the car and up top here. And even the other one is pretty easy to get to just to open up. It's this one against the firewall that's gonna cause the most headache for anybody that's ever had to change that or has to change that. That's gonna be a big pain in the ass. I spent hours on that one. It looked pretty fast on the time lapse, but trying to get that crow foot in the right place was the big pain in the ass there. But anyways, this is pretty much done.
Hey guys, thanks for tuning in all the way to the end of this quick video on doing the oxygen sensors on the IS300. If you guys have ever done this oxygen sensor or need to do it in the future, I hope you guys got some tips from what I did here. You know, the hardest one is that Binh-Tuner sensor 1, which is against the firewall. The other three sensors on this car are pretty damn easy. If you guys found this video informative, don't forget to like it. If you haven't subscribed to your channel, subscribe to your channel. I always post these DIY for the IS300 or my IS250 or any of the cars I'm working on around the house or anything else I'm doing. If you like that kind of stuff, don't forget to tune in and subscribe. I'll talk to you guys next time on the next video.